Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Hello, Knife Junkie, and welcome to the midweek supplemental episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim, the Knife Newbie Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco. Welcome to the show.
The Knife Junkie, Bob. You are him.
In person. It is me. It is I indeed.
The midweek's supplemental episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast, where Bob gets a chance to, I'm going to use my favorite word that I learned from Bob, bloviate about knives. And if you don't know what that means, I don't either, but I just love saying it. But Bob gets a chance to talk about knives, and that's what we're going to do tonight.
It's kind of onomatopoetic, which is a hard word to say, but it's kind of, it is what it sounds like. It's going on at length like a bag of hot air, I think.
Wow. That's really a stretch for you, isn't it?
Yeah, right.
Hey, we've got a good show coming up for you today. Going to hear a couple of voicemails from listeners. We've promised to do that. So as long as you keep calling and leaving messages, we're going to keep playing them.
Keep them coming.
That's right. Bob's got a chance to talk about a knife he's had the opportunity to review, the ZT-0223 that Buddy Stu gave him to on loan to review. Yeah. I know we had just had the Super Bowl, but I'm going to talk about avocados in the Wall Street Journal. So, what does that mean? We'll find out. we're going to see what new knife is in Bob's hand most recently. Wink, wink, the Strider SMF. And we're going to have our Knife Life News segment. Of course, we'll also have some knife shows to take a look at. And then our featured segment tonight, Bob's going to have a chance to talk about Mick Strider and Strider Knives. So a jam-packed show, Bob.
Yeah, indeed. Actually, I'm going to talk a little bit more specifically about the history of the SMF after receiving it, which I was going to leave as a surprise, but I guess that's not a possibility now, Jim, is it? You lick my wife. You're full of spoilers, man. No, I'm just kidding. But I'm going to talk a little bit about the SMF because after getting it back in hand, I used to have one, and then I just bought one from Terrell, Zellrich 42, and it's a different model, and oh my gosh, it's a revelation. So made me do a little tiny bit of research about it. It's an interesting knife.
Well, did you want to go ahead and talk about your new Strider while you broached the subject and I spoiled the spoiled the news?
Well, you know what? I think I want to talk first, if you don't mind. Let's go with what you laid out, and we'll get back to that. That'll be kind of like a cliffhanger for people.
Oh, okay.
But first, I want to urgently say that the zero tolerance 0223. I need to say that I gave it an unfair shake. Now, I don't know what in what show, but I know it's been a couple of times on the Knife Junkie Podcast. I've sort of lambasted the design of the 0223, kind of calling it things like superfluous or like busy or whatever. And having mentioned my dissatisfaction with this knife, the 223 was kind of the big release for zero tolerance in 2019. One of our awesome listeners, Stu, who's got a knife company up in Vermont called Stone and Steel, and he goes around to different gun and knife shows up in New England and sells knives. Anyway, he got in touch with me, said, I think maybe you really need to get the 223 in hand before you make such severe and harsh judgments on such a lovely knife. Now, he didn't say that like that, but that was what I inferred from this. So he sent me this knife. I've had it for nearly a week. I told him I would keep it for a week. He was very genteel in his note to me to say, by the way, this is a loaner. So check it out, make a video, and please send it back because I love it so much. And I see why. Actually, when this knife was released, I remember looking at it and just kind of dismissing it and thinking, boy, Zero Tolerance really lost their compass. It's a Tim Gallion design. Tim Gallion works for Kai USA. I believe he's an in-house designer as well as a custom maker in his own right. And this knife is a tribute to military combat knives, to our current bayonet. Also, you can see some influence of the K-bar in the blade. And in looking at it on paper, it looks like there's a lot going on in the design. But then when you get it in hand, you know, to me, okay, I just made a video of this, Jim. So this will post in the next week or so, a review of this just from carrying it for a week or so. And to me, there is one too many design flourishes on it. But that being said, it's definitely not a deal breaker. This knife is extremely sharp. It's got great action, has a wonderful feel in the hand. It's like the perfect thickness. And then this wraparound G10 over the top of the handle, the spine of the handle, I wrote off as a gimmick, you know, just because it's fun to make snap judgments sometimes. But in hand, boy, that G10 going over the top and creating sort of a solid handle feel is great. So this knife, I just want to say here and now, I definitely made a snap judgment due to my first impressions of the design of this knife, just aesthetically, and then getting it in hand, you know, changed me 180 degrees.
Wow.
Okay. I really dig this knife now.
Yeah. What's the one thing that you were surprised by?
I was surprised that in person, the design looks great. I love the way it looks when I'm holding it in my hand. Mm. But it was making me angry when I was looking at it on paper for some reason. Mm. So polarizing design, you might say, but really getting in hand and feeling the solidity of it. But also it's, you know, it rides beautifully in the pocket. It's not a very big knife. Mm. So you get a lot of blade for the size, but yeah.
What was the, you said there was one too many design flourishes. So you still have one additional design flourish you don't like.
Yeah. Okay. So of the design flourishes, I would say the overall handle shape, especially towards the tail end, is looks a little funky, but in hand, in reverse grip, the tail end of the knife is perfect for locking your thumb on. So design flourish, that's the first one. The second one would be the G10 going over the top of the handle. The third would be the sort of shell extractor shape of the forward part of the handle. The fourth would be the holes drilled in the handle. There are five little superfluous holes in the ricasso drilled in. The fifth would be the cut through fuller. And then the sixth would be the large notched jimping on top. So it's a busy looking thing. But in real life, it seems fine. To me, like I said, my eye just wants to get rid of those five holes drilled into the ricasso. Other than that, beauty.
All right. So the ZT0223 is now on the Knife Junkie's list of purchases?
it is not, because the Knife Junkie's list of purchases has been too long for too long.
Right.
So it's not there yet, but I do dig it.
All right. So a great knife, and a review video of that will be on the Knife Junkie's YouTube channel at thenifejunkie.com/YouTube, thenifejunkie.com/YouTube. And you can check that out and get to see it more in person, if you will, and leave your comments to Bob about if you agree or disagree with all these design flourishes and his change of tune about the 0223. All right, let's move on. Let's get some feedback from our listeners, Bob, going to the listener line, which, by the way, you can call and leave a message 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That number is 724-466-4487, 724-466-4487. There's not a voice mail message from the Knife Junkie, so you won't hear him when you call. It'll just be a quick message with a recording to leave a message. But do so, and we'd love to play your comments on the air on an upcoming podcast. And one of these, the first one, Bob, is from Dave from Connecticut, who was one of those that actually somehow got lost in our systems. It had been a few months ago when he had called, and we actually did a segment on the Thursday Night Knives show with this topic. He wanted to know about knife storage and get some ideas how folks stored their knives. So we used that for a Thursday Night Knives segment. But let's hear that now, and then I want to come back and get your thoughts on it.
This is Dave from Connecticut. A question I'd like to ask you for your show to consider as a question is the same one I emailed to you, but I think it's been a while. I think my email may end up in your junk mail. Anyway, maybe you could do a show on the best way to store knife collections, because I've found that with well over 100 folders that it is a challenge to keep them all in one place, keep them readily available, keep them safe, out of the wrong hands, et cetera, all at the same time. So I've seen a number of solutions. I have a few of my own, and just wondering what you guys think. Okay, best of luck and great show.
Okay, Dave, thanks so much for that comment. And again, apologies for taking us so long to get to it. Just one of those things. But knife storage, Bob, I know that's something you and I talked about in the early days of putting this podcast together. I was like, you know, as the knife newbie, that's kind of a question I had. How do you store these things after you buy 2 or 10 or 20? So
a lot of
good suggestions and ideas.
Yeah, I think a lot of people approach it, you know, in their different ways. I've seen, you know, a lot of it depends on where you're planning on taking your collection. But in terms of size, I personally have found that a craftsman or otherwise, you know, husky or something like that, a metal tool chest with the ball bearing drawers and the top hatch is the way for me to go. I have a Craftsman. It's got 6 drawers and a top that swings open. And I put some of that, you know, that stuff you put under carpet or you put under your cutting board that kind of cushions and stops things from moving around.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I lined all the drawers with that so that the knives can nestle securely in the drawers without moving around when I open the drawers and without getting scratched up on the metal surface of the drawers. So to me, that is my preferred way because I can also open up the drawer or open up the top and get a good view of a good number of knives at once. And I'm seeing the full sides of them. Whereas, the second very, very, very popular option, I've always had that problem with it, that you can't see the sides of the knife. And that's the Pelican case. Pelican cases are these awesome you can regulate the air pressure inside for flight, and they're waterproof cases that were originally designed for electronics, and you know, we use that a lot in video and those kind of applications. But a lot of people also store their knife collections in Pelican cases, and you can get the foam inserts that are optimized for plucking and creating spaces for knives. And it's a great sort of innovative way to store your knives, but I have 2 main problems with them. The first one I just told you about is when you slip a knife into a Pelican case, all you're seeing is the butt end or the top end. You can't see the full knife, you know, from the side. Right. And to me, that's just something I like when I'm looking at my collection. That's a personal thing. My second problem with the Pelican case is that it's so very portable. You know, it's just a case with a great ergonomic handle, you know, that makes the whole thing seem light. You can pick it up and walk right off with it.
Grab it and go.
Yeah, exactly. Now, granted, you could take a tool chest, but it just takes a little more doing. You know what I mean? So I love the Pelican idea, and I think it's probably a really great thing for the knives themselves to keep them secure from the elements. But the portability and the fact that you can't really get a good view of the knives kind of bothers me. Now, the third and final option that I'll cover, and of course, there are many, many, many other ways to store knives, but I think this is another popular way, is now I'm not sure what to call these, but they're like storage boxes you get at Bed Bath & Beyond. And you might store your winter clothes in them and put them in the attic. Well, that's what we do in this house. But, you know, the big plastic storage bins with the lids.
Right.
That is what I keep my knife boxes in. I keep all the boxes to all the knives I have in case I decide to resell them. But I know that a lot of people like to store their knives either in cases or in the boxes they ship in and then keep those in those kind of plastic containers because they supply a decent amount of protection from water damage anyway. And they're kind of a neat way to stack and stash things, especially if you have a high volume of knives, you know.
And not a lot of space to store them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Okay. So do you have other storage options? We'd love to hear from you. Call the listener line at 724-466-4487, 724-466-4487, and let us know what your favorite way to store your knives is.
I'd be remiss if I didn't add right here that a good friend of the podcast and to Thursday Night Knives, Alex Dassault of Alex's Knife Box, well, his whole channel and his whole, you know, online identity is based around his knife storage, and he's discussed it on the show. He has a sort of cool clandestine way of storing his knives in a big leather, what do you call it, kind of footstool slash coffee table thing that actually opens up and then has, you know, you can put safes and stuff inside. So he has all of his amazing, beautiful knives sort of hidden in plain view and kind of unobtrusive in a piece of furniture that gets otherwise used.
In a box, which is the knife box, hence Alex's knife box.
Exactly.
Wow, he's smart. All right. Thanks, Dave, for that question. Get us thinking about knife storage options. And another voicemail that we got from Tori Murphy, who was relaying back to a request from episode number 65, where it was the Knife Junkie's top 10 most carried knives of 2019. And he had some thoughts that really made the Knife Junkie go, So let's hear what that is.
Hey, guys, this is Tori Murphy, Murph Nuge on Instagram. Just getting caught up listening to the podcast. Regarding episode 65, you guys talked about best knives of the year, things like that. And I think you guys were pretty spot on with your tastes. I don't have much of the same taste, so the Spydercos didn't do anything for me. But the Gerber Fastball, for me, was probably surprisingly an eye-opener, especially from Gerber. Over the years, they've dwindled as far as quality. It seems like they're trying to come back a little bit more American made. They're focusing more on that. I was really surprised by that one. I ended up picking up a Spartan Harsty folder that's lived in my pocket since I picked it up. And honestly, those are my two for the year. But for the rest of yours, I was really impressed with the rest of the list. So get out there and keep them sharp.
All right, Bob. So interesting comments there from Tori, and I know you were just like going, oh.
well, both knives resonated for two different reasons. He mentioned the Gerber Fastball. And for me, the Fastball was the first knife I'd seen in the past couple of years coming out of Gerber that I said, nice move. And it felt good because in the 70s, growing up, my dad had a Gerber. It was sort of a 110-ish Gerber, but it had a sleeker, more modern profile, and it came in a beautiful leather case. And he kept it way up on his bookshelf, and whenever I could kind of grab it, I would. And I coveted that thing, and I always thought Gerber, man, someday when I'm older, I'm going to have a Gerber. And you know, they sort of fell off a little bit, but now they're making their return, and I think the Fastball, what a great way to do that. And then he mentions the Spartan Harsey, which is a knife that is on my short drool list. I love that knife. It is beautiful. Anything that Bill Harsey lays his hand to is beautiful as far as I'm concerned. Every knife I've ever seen him, he designed a Gerber knife that was cheap and not great, but it was beautiful. He has the eye and the hand. And so that Spartan Harsey, that's one I want to get my hands on. So when I heard him mention that, I felt jealous, not envious. I want him to have one too,
okay.
But I felt jealous.
All right. Well, good for Tori calling in and getting some feelings there from the Knife Junkie. So anyway, thanks to Dave and Tori both for calling in, leaving messages on the listener line. Again, please give us a call. Leave your comments, your thoughts, your questions. Love to hear from you. Love to get some additional voices on the Knife Junkie podcast.
Have a knife you want featured or reviewed? Call the Knife Junkies 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487 and let us know.
Hey, Bob, Super Bowl last weekend. Did you have a chance to get some chips and some dip or maybe some guacamole?
Yeah, I did all of those things. But the reason I really wanted to mention this, bring this up, is that I saw something hilarious and knife-oriented because we got to keep it that way here.
Oh, absolutely.
In the Wall Street Journal, and it was, here was the headline, Super Bowl means avocado hand is back with a vengeance. And it made me think, avocado hand, what is that again?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's an ailment that afflicts hipsters making their avocado toast, but who have no idea how to de-seed an avocado. And this was going around. I remember a couple of years back, it was like this thing that was going around social media and the sidebar of the news websites where people were, avocados, for some reason, after being on Earth for several billion years, were really hitting stride a couple of years ago with avocado toast and other avocado things. So people were cutting a lot of them and, you know, you stick the knife in, you drag it around the seed, you spin it and you open it up. And then you have to get the seed out of the one side. And of course, it's kind of like golf ball shaped and everything is slimy in there. So how do you do that? Well, people were taking the point of their knives and trying to stab it. And I really appreciate the spirit of the thrust right. and such. But in this case, it's the wrong surface. A hard, slick, rounded surface is the wrong thing to stab at. So what you want to do, so people were getting avocado hand, which meant they were stabbing at the pit. The blade glanced off the pit and goes through the avocado, which is very soft, and through the hand. So it was a condition that was actually being recognized, I believe, by the AMA. I'm sure someone will correct me if I'm wrong, but it was a term that was getting serious play in the medical circles.
Right.
Anyway, I'm here to tell you that if you don't know how to take the seed out of an avocado, I'm sure if you're listening to the Knife Junkie podcast, you probably know. But after you spin the avocado and you take the half away that does not have the seed, you just take the edge of the knife and you lightly hack into it. And lightly hack the edge of it, the straight edge of your blade, into the seed. And then you just turn it like a clock and it'll pop right out. Mm-hmm. So that's the way to do it. That's the way to avoid avocado hand.
Well, and if you want to read that article and learn more, we'll have a link in the show notes at thenifejunkie.com/83, thenifejunkie.com/83.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie podcast. And now here's the Knife Junkie with the Knife Life News.
All right, Jim. So the last couple of shows, we've been talking about revelations from the 2020 SHOT Show. All the companies are coming out and showing what they're going to be featuring in their 2020 lineups. And I thought that was winding down. And then I saw the Topps releases. And you know, I love Topps knives. So I have to tell you what I'm thinking from what I see here. As always, lots of cool things from Topps. They're doing some new things. It seems like every year they challenge themselves in a way that, just pushes their product line and expands the kind of people who their knives appeal to. They started off as low speed, high drag, knives for operators. And no doubt they still make those kind of knives, but they've also expanded into camp knives, outdoors knives, and even EDC. So this year, a couple of things that are really turning my eye are they have this Yukon Hawk. They have two new axes coming out this year. The Yukon Hawk is the smaller of the two. It's got a almost 5-inch blade with a very uniquely shaped handle that really maximizes the leverage of an axe. I like that they're going into axe making. They've been doing that for a few years now with their using their sort of signature quarter inch thick 1095 Crovan. What a great material. And, their whole recipe for making a knife translates beautifully into making axes. In terms of chopping, we're talking about chopping. Let's talk about the Bestia or the Bestia. I'm not sure how it's pronounced, but since I don't see two A's, I'm going to call it the Bestia. And it is they call it the spiritual successor to the El Chete. The El Chete, as you remember, was the big, giant, sort of cleavery machete chopper designed by Leo Espinoza that came out last year. Well, this is like, imagine a Kukri, but all the curves are straight lines. So it's a big inward turning chopper without curves. So it's two straight lines. It is a menacing, unique looking thing. It also looks like it might present a challenge to sharpen in the elbow of the blade, but it just looks like a brutal piece of outdoors-like equipment there. They have a great-looking filet knife coming out that is built on the Lioness platform. That looks cool. They have something new this year, which is they're calling it the Muley Skinner and Saw, and it's a combo for hunters. So you have a knife for skinning that looks somewhat reminiscent to the Tex Creek, but a little more svelte. And then you have the Muley saw that goes with it. And that's, for the sort of sawing applications you would need during hunting. And they fit in a complementary sheath. And it's a cool little two-tooled package. Two others that really jump out at me. Jim, this one, I'm going to have to figure out how to get this really quickly. It's called the Storm Vector. Storm Vector. Cool name. It's a giant 12.7-inch Sacks. It looks like it might be, it's like machete length, but it's more like just a big giant Viking sacks. And, that's right up my alley. And, I've never seen Topps do something like this. It's got a very ergonomic looking handle, curvy, and looks like it provides great grip. And that terminates into this wildly angular and creepy looking sax blade. So I love that. And then the last knife from Topps that I wanted to mention was the, no, sorry, two more knives from Topps. You know, every year they do an employee knife design competition. You might remember Craig Powell mentioning that. Well, this is the third year they've done that. And what they've come up with, or what one of the employees of Topps came up with, is a 4.5-inch clip blade. It's very simple. It's called the Trail Seeker. It looks very simple, but extremely useful. And I got to say, it's a pretty handsome looking knife too. So it's cool that they do that. I think it's great. Gives the way to build morale and let them take a little bit more ownership of the stuff they're making.
Right.
Two quick things. The Unzipper, also built on the Lioness platform, except it's got an inverted blade, meaning the top edge where the spine of the blade normally is sharp. And that is for very specialized kind of self-defense uses. Interesting. It's kind of trendy and interesting, but really takes a lot of getting used to. And I would hazard to say quite a bit of training to make that effective. But for those of you who do that, I have no doubt Topps makes a great one.
Right.
And then finally, and I would say this is probably the one that they're leading with this year, is the Knight Spike. It's this very attractive, it sounds creepy saying that, but it's a very nice looking recurved tanto that is long and spiky and thin, and it's got about half of the top edge is sharpened or sharpenable. And really, it's built to be a throwing knife, but it looks like a knife I would love to just have and just kind of wear on my belt. It's a 5.5-inch knife that is really set up to throw, but I say sharpen it and wear it in the small of your back.
All right. Keep it with you.
Yeah, that's right. The knight spike. I'm not throwing that away. No way.
All right. So a lot of knives there from Topps that you wanted to hit.
Yeah. Thank you for indulging me. But, you know, yeah. Every year they make so many knives. And as I mentioned when I spoke with Craig Powell, it always amazes me that they have such a huge and broad product line. And then when you go to the major retailers, they almost always have it all available, except for the things that they've retired, you know, right, for good.
All right. So Topps, but also quickly, some new knives from K-Bar that you wanted to get.
Yes. Real quickly, the Becker BK18. That's another Ethan Becker knife, but this one's a little bit smaller. It's a 4.5-inch, 4.6-inch harpoon-style kind of a clip point blade, I would call it. I mean, it looks kind of like a harpoon-style Bowie, but this is unique in that it's set up with a polymer sheath and it's got a tan coating. And to me, it just looks a little more tactical than camp. And I always kind of think of Ethan Becker stuff as outdoors and campy. This looks a little more stabby and adventuresome. And then the other knife from K-Bar that is very interesting to me is the new Gunny knife. It's the last project that Arlie Ermey, as you know him as Gunny, he was the drill sergeant in Full Metal Jacket, very involved in the knife community before his death, and he worked on this. It's a beautiful, big-looking outdoors knife. 9.75 inches. It's a 1095. It's got a big leaf shape, recurved. To me, the reason I like it so much is it's evocative, kind of a barong, you know, a Filipino barong with some fresh English put on it. But it's a very attractive looking knife. So I think they're gonna hit the ground running with that one.
And now that we're caught up with Knife Life News, let's hear more of the Knife Junkie Podcast.
All right, back on the Knife Junkie Podcast, kind of a featured segment. I wanted a chance to talk a little bit more in depth about the Strider SMF. So I'll just let you bloviate.
Well, thank you. As you know, I got my new SMF from Terrell Todd. You know him as Zelric 42. We were talking on the last Thursday Night Knives, or a couple of weeks back, and he was mentioning, we were talking about Striders, and he mentioned his nice little collection. I said, if you're ever looking to unload one, I've been looking for an SMF for a while. And boy, did he have one for me that he was looking to get rid of. An SMF, it's a concealed carry. That means it's thinner than your average Lego SMF. And it's the handle is contoured and it really rides in pocket beautifully. He sent it to me. I got it today. I've been so excited about it. And I've been doing a little research about it. And I just wanted to bloviate about it. The SMF was actually originally designed for the first Special Operations Command unit of the Marine Corps called Detachment 1. And so this was an outfit that it was the first outfit in the Marine Corps to be issued a knife in 40 years since World War II. The last knife that was issued was the Marine Raider Stiletto, a long, thin, sort of Fairbairn Sykes-inspired, murdery sort of dagger thing. Not great for utility, great for a couple of tasks. And so this group thought they might be doing some covert operations, so they decided they wanted a folding knife, something robust like a fixed blade knife, but something that could fold so they could move about slightly more discreetly. So that's what they ended up making. And so Mick Strider designed the SMF, and they ended up making 300 versions of the knife. They made, this is interesting, 150 for these operators in the Marine Corps. And then they made 150 for civilians. And they made the civilian version with black G10, whereas the military version was a coyote brown. And they put serial numbers on the civilian version. And yeah. Yeah. And so the whole purpose of doing that was to sort of offset the cost to the Navy commissioning these knives.
And that was nice.
Yeah. It's, and in doing so, created a rabid fan base for this knife. This knife was, as one general mentioned, selected by, built for, and issued to the United States Marine Corps SOCOM Detachment 1.
That's pretty cool. You said that so well.
Didn't that sound cool? Yeah. And now I have one. I'm very excited. So, I've got the Holy Triumvirate back together. That's the Hinderer Strider. Chris Reeve sort of triumvirate. So I'm going to see how that works for me.
Okay. What? Explain that again for me real quick, the triumvirate.
Oh, well, these are the three royal holy knives of tactical knife, you know, legacy.
Okay.
So everyone, in the knife world for a long time, they were considered the three greatest folding tactical knives. The Chris Reeve Sebenza, the XM24 or XM18 by Rick Hinderer, and the Strider SMF or SNG.
Which now you have to complete.
Yes.
All right, cool.
All is good now.
All right. So a little bit of kind of first toolish segment there, a little bit of history, but that was a kind of cool story there to learn how it came about and offsetting the cost to the military. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, because, you know, they need whatever.
Yeah, yes. Well, we won't go there, but yeah, nice touch or thought or marketing ploy or whatever, but yeah. All right.
You know you're a knife junkie if you love your knives more than your kids.
Hey, before we get out of here, last minute or two of the show, I do want to remind you, we try to cover some knife shows to put on your calendar, only one in February. If you want to go to Las Vegas, be nice and warm there. If you happen to be in the north, be a good time to get away. February 28th to Sunday, March 1st, that's in Las Vegas, the Las Vegas Custom Knife Maker Show. Several shows in March, not going to get a chance to cover all of them, but March 6th and 7th, go to Troy, Ohio for the Spirit of the Blade Custom Knife Show. Then Friday, March 13th to Saturday, March 14th, it's the Track Rock Hammer Inn, that's going to be in Blairsville, Georgia. North Carolina, the Tar Heel Cutlery Club Show. That's going to be Friday and Saturday, March 20 and March 21. Arkansas Knife Show, that's a big one. That's going to be Saturday, March 21st. That's going to be in Little Rock, Arkansas. The Dalton, Georgia Knife Road Show, March 27 and 28. And then the Bunker Hill Knife Club Show, March 27 and March 28, also Friday and Saturday. That's in Godfrey, Illinois. And again, thanks to our friends at Knife Magazine that puts together an awesome list of knife shows and knife club events, which is where we're pulling this information from, theknifemagazine.com/events. So, Bob, as we wrap up this midweek supplemental episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast, episode number 83, that you can find show notes for and links to things that we've mentioned here at theknifejunkie.com/83, turn it over to you for the final word from the Knife Junkie.
Well, I would say this. Do check in with our Thursday Night Knives, because oftentimes we break out some of the things we mention right here in this podcast, and we get a chance to open them up and really talk about them. So definitely check out Thursday Night Knives and comment, engage, and let's get the conversation going.
Yeah, and if you're listening to this podcast when it drops, as they say, on Wednesdays. Thursday Night Knives is tomorrow night. But if you're listening after the fact on Thursday, join us tonight. If you're listening on a Friday or a Saturday, hey, go to theknifejunkie.com/live. That's L-I-V-E. We have an archive of all the past episode of Thursday Night Knives right there that you can listen and watch. All right. Thanks for listening and joining us on the Knife Junkie Podcast. For Bob, the Knife Junkie DeMarco, I'm Jim Person saying thanks for joining us.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram, and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.